Hi everyone, welcome to this video. Let's paint an axolotl. So I'm going to start with black paint to create the outline. Oftentimes I'll start with the head. So notice the placement and the size of this oval shape that I'm making, kind of to the left of center here, and almost in the middle if you were to create a horizontal line. This is part of the chest area and body. So the axolotl apparently is pronounced more like ashlot, but I'm just gonna continue with the colloquial use of it, since most people pronounce it axolotl. I'm going to get rid of this line later when we add our color. Not sure if you can hear that noise in the background. That's my dog enjoying a rawhide. Just going to kind of map out where the gills are, which are the fronds on the head here. But when I go into them later, these lines probably will not exist, as I feel like I just want to make it be about the color and not having black lines around it. This is actually how they breathe. And they spend their entire life in water. And they can live up to 15 years. So anywhere from 10 to 15 years. I'm gonna create a line here, kind of showing the back of the body. And maybe Maybe I'll actually angle it up this way. This is the tail. I'm sitting very close to my computer in order to record this, so sometimes my elbow hits the table. And I think I want to just make the body a little bit thinner here. Maybe bring the head down a little bit more. That may be a little confusing for some with all these extra lines. There's the mouth there. And the eye, notice the placement. It's pretty close to the edge of the head here. And a little bit above, depending on how large you want to make the mouth. A little bit above the corner of the mouth there. This line is kind of the indicator of the where the body and the tail continue. Seems to have kind of a very thin piece of skin on the top and the bottom of the tail. Axolotls are actually pretty interesting creatures, as they can fully regenerate their limbs without any scar tissue. I'm using heavy-bodied acrylics and I'm going to make them a little bit wetter so I can lay down the black a little bit easier. Maybe this little creature is on some type of a twig or small branch in the water. I kind of like the repetitiveness of this shape here with the shape of the tail, starting off larger and then receding to a smaller diameter. I am working from a photo, however, I often don't really know what else I'm going to include in the painting until I'm painting it. remember this line. We've shortened so that one. This line here doesn't really exist. And that is the upper part of the branch there. And I think for now, what we'll do for the rest of the background is we will see what develops when we add the color. So to make the black line, I was using a smaller pointed brush. Does not say what kind of brush this is. And for the background, I'm switching to a larger brush here. This is a filbert. And that way we can cover more of the background quickly. I'm using quinacridone magenta. Not really sure how to pronounce that. And just straight without mixing it with any other colors at this point. Go ahead and put on some of your favorite music if you'd like as you're creating. Was checking for my cat to see if she wanted in. Okay, I think now I'm going to switch to a different color. I feel like I want to create some greens. And maybe some blues. We'll see what happens. So these little animals are found in only one lake in the wild in Mexico City. painting over the black lines just a little bit. Since I don't plan on keeping them for those gills. Acrylic paint does dry fairly quickly. However, I'm working quickly as well, and some of my black is not dry yet, so I sometimes accidentally get it into my paint. Not a big deal. So the color that you see here is made up of this magenta here, which I will have written in the description, and cadmium yellow medium, and a little bit of manganese blue hue, kind of all mixed together in varying ratios. And see how it differed over here, but we can carry some of that color over there as well. Maybe we'll make it a little more green. I'm adding some burnt sienna to that mixture for this little underwater branch here. And we can go in with a smaller brush later to get in the details, but I managed to cover that area pretty good in there between the toes. I am going to use a smaller brush to get in to that area there. And then maybe we can carry some of this brown color around the background here just a little bit. But Emma, that is my dog getting upset at one of my cats. We don't get a lot of exercise in the winter time, and she gets a little cranky. Okay, I was just adding some more yellow to my palette. And now let's go in and put the color on to the axolotl. They tend, depending on the axolotl, but often you see them with kind of a really light pink or peachish color. So I'm using white, yellow, and a medium magenta, which is like a pink. I'm gonna add a little more yellow to that, and I'll probably end up putting a nice another layer of color on after, which might be a little lighter, but it's nice to have layers sometimes to give it a little bit of depth. I was just painting over that first line that we had made for the face there. Now we can see it start to take shape a little bit more. When I was looking for animals to paint for these videos, I ran across a photo of this creature and thought it was so cute. And surprised to learn that so many people, especially the young'uns, know what an axolotl is, or they're familiar with it. Okay, I'm gonna wait to do the toes there. I'll switch to a smaller brush at some point. So I'm just continuing to mix colors on my palette as I go. So I added a little bit more white. I'm gonna go ahead and actually put some of this lighter color on here right now. This is the quinacridone mixed with some yellow and whatever was on my paintbrush for the light part of the body there. And we can go back in later and add more detail as we continue on. You can use your own technique with how you want to do this. I'm just doing what's coming to me. Switch to a smaller brush so I can get into the toe area there. I want to give a shout out to Evelyn, who loves axolotls. Hi, Evelyn. Okay. I think I want to add some, let's see, maybe some purple in the background. See how that looks. So I'm using medium magenta and blue manganese hue for this. This is quite a vibrant underwater scene. Okay, so we'll leave it at that for now. And go back in and create some more black lines for the second layer. Switching to a smaller brush, which is a round petite. Quite worn and frayed from use. I'm going to start on the right side here so that my hand doesn't drag across the wet paint, because I often, even though some of this is still wet, but the newly wet black lines, because often I will rest the heel of my hand down to steady my brush stroke. And I hope you're sitting in a comfortable position or standing in a comfortable position as you create art. I am working on the sitting to the side of the painting here. So it's not how I normally would be creating. This line is the indication of the kind of the back end of the body, which I may make less visible when we add more color, because it's really no separation there. face is a little rounder than what an axolotl is, so I think I'm gonna try to make it a little more oval by dropping this line down here. Notice how this back line here for the back kind of continues on. If you were to continue drawing a line there, it'd be a continuous line. I like working with acrylic paint because it's easy to layer the paint. It's fast drying. And so you can easily paint over areas that you want to change. And if you lay the paint on really thick, you'll have some texture to your painting. I made this little mark here to indicate that the leg here is kind of in the foreground, and then the rest of the body recedes. And then I am going to drop that line down a little bit to have a continuous line here. And I will go back in and erase this by painting over it. Looks like we have a few lines to paint over near the top of the head, which the black is still very wet, so we'll wait on that. And I'm just gonna check on my cat again. Okay, so looking at this piece right now, like I said, I don't really know what I'm doing for the background when I go in. I have kind of a general idea sometimes, but sometimes I don't. I'm not sure if I like how busy it is right now. I'm gonna actually go and get some clean water. And perhaps we'll see what it looks like if I add create more of a purple background. Some different shades of purple, violet. I'm going to switch to a smaller brush. I'm using a filbert. About this size. And maybe make some, like a nice green. like the repetitiveness of these green shapes here with the fronds, the gills on the head. So obviously create the background the way you would like to create it, whatever colors resonate with you. Maybe it's just a completely flat background with one color. Maybe it's a blue. Not really doing too much thinking when I'm creating. Some of it's a thought process, but it's more of a feeling for me. And what feels aesthetically pleasing. Okay, I think we'll just leave the background for now. And I'm gonna go back in to the branch there with some burnt sienna, yellow, and white. using a little bit of the dry brush technique there. And maybe carry some of that color. Into the background as well. Okay, now let's go back into the body. I'm using a filbert again, one of my favorite brushes to use. Using white and medium magenta and a little bit of yellow. There might be some sanguine or burnt sienna in there as well. I'll often shape my black lines, as you can see with the placement of color, as opposed to it being solely created with the by painting the black line on. Add a couple of layers there to cover up the black line. again, covering over that black line to reposition the body line there. I'm going to go back over this with a lighter color. And the that thin part of the tail is quite translucent, so I think I'm gonna add just a little bit of that sort of green color. To the white. And the light pink color. I'm just taking that same color. Felt like spreading it around the background a little. Go back over that translucent part of the tail again with a whiter kind of pink. With acrylic paint, it does darken as it dries, so you want to keep that in mind when you place your color down. You mix it. So it may look like there's a lot of contrast there right now, but as it dries, there may be quite a bit less contrast. And let's go into that other part of the tail there in the back, using some white, medium magenta, and yellow. Just to give it a little bit of depth, different coloring. Some of the previous layers will show through a little bit, which is nice. I'm going to switch to a smaller brush to go in to the toes. And we'll have to go back in and put some black line there. I kind of like how I changed the background a little bit, taking away that really vibrant pink. Because I like the way the green contrasts with the subtle pinks of the axolotl. Pink and green can sometimes be a really nice color combination. I just shortened that line a little bit. And I'm going to go into that back leg there with some green in the background to try to distinguish the toes a little bit more, because they tend to be a little more elongated and separate, and those were quite close together. And while I have that green, I might as well go in and put some little details in the background. And I'm going to go into the log a little bit around that foot to get some, just to put that layer on there that I couldn't get it to with a larger brush. maybe make a few details on the log as well. Using white and burnt sienna primarily. Just gives it a little bit of variety. Okay, so now let's go into the fronds, the gills on the head there. First, I'm going to cover up the black lines that are there when I repositioned the head, just so we can see what we're working with here and get that layer to be consistent. Okay, so what I am noticing is that, well, they're all unique and different, because they are unique individuals, but some of them tend to have a darker color in the center. So let's see if we can do that here and how that looks. The reference photo I'm using kind of looks like almost like a purple even. And notice I'm not really carrying it all the way to the end. But again, they may look different depending on the creature. Okay, I'm going to actually go into the background a little bit near the log. So I want to refine this line a little bit. And maybe pull this color up there, kind of a continuation. And I'm just kind of intuitively going around and seeing where I want to place some of this color. this is just some little bits of stuff in the water there on the ground. So even though we did, or I did, paint over quite a bit of the original background that I had laid down, we wouldn't have gotten to where we were, or are now, without that first layer. And this layer wouldn't look the same without the layers underneath. Okay, so let's go back into the gills, maybe add a little bit of detail using a smaller brush. Using medium magenta, yellow, and the quinacridone magenta. And maybe I'll make it a little darker so we can see. Some of the details. Kind of frilly. Could make it lighter as well. And I may go back in. Create some lighter ones. We'll see. Just kind of make it look a little frilly. You can get as detailed as you want. And I'm just gonna maybe try to carry some of that color into the background here. Just a little bit of detail. Kind of clustering the bits of color together in certain areas. Okay, I'm going to go back in with some black line. Into the foot area. And maybe make the eyes completely black as well. Then we can go back in later. And create the little light that shines on them. Although looking at the photos, that's not really how they are, but this is not meant to be a realistic portrayal. I want this line to be too dark, but more subtle than anything. I may go back in here to refine that line a little bit with using color. And maybe make this outside line a little stronger. Your lines can vary in thickness. Or be the same thickness. gonna go back into the body and touch up a few spots, highlight a few spots. And shape the black line a little bit more. That black is still wet there. Might have to go back in and blend that a little later as it dries. Okay, I think I am gonna switch to a slightly larger brush of filbert, just to lighten up some areas in the axolotl to really highlight it. Now, as this dries, hopefully a lot of the pink will still show through. Switching to a smaller brush to add a little more highlights on the feet, which have very much blended in as the paint dried and darkened. switching back to a larger brush, I am going to go into the tail again and try to make the center part of the tail a little less contrasty with the rest of it. Kind of lightly, almost dry brushing. And I'm going to go into the eyes now and create a couple of marks to indicate the light shining. So slightly off-white. And then a really light pink to create the nostrils. And I am feeling like putting some spirals in this piece. I use spirals in a lot of my work. I believe it's actually one of the oldest symbols in art. I'm going to switch to a smaller brush to continue. Just a little bit more detail. Again, I'm just kind of feeling my way around the canvas. And one thing, placing the same shape in different areas or the same mark. One thing that does is it helps to carry the eye around the piece. Every part of the canvas is, I would say, equally as important as any other. maybe just one more spiral somewhere. Sometimes I have the spirals going one way, clockwise, and others I have them going counterclockwise to kind of balance the energy out. Maybe just a few more. I'm making these dots a little bit smaller, and I think they're a little bit whiter, but they may blend in as well when they darken. Okay, I think we can call this one finished, and I hope you had fun. I certainly did, and thank you for joining me.